Well, good evening and welcome to all of you who've managed to find us and join us for this service of worship of Reynard Way Church this evening. I wonder if you've ever just asked the question, what is church all about? Why are we doing this? Why sit down of an evening and watch church? After all, there are more entertaining things to do. Why not sit down and watch a series on Netflix or something like that? Well, part of the answer to the question is that Christianity, once you understand the teachings of what Christianity is about, it is so life-changing. There's like a seed that when it's planted, it just grows up and changes you so radically that it becomes a fundamental part of who you are, and it changes your desires and what you want to do. And so for us who know Jesus Christ, who belong to him, the opportunity of meeting, albeit in a distant way, but to worship him is something that excites us and something that we want to give ourselves to. Let me just introduce you to something of what God says about himself and about us as we begin our worship this evening. God says in his word, "For your maker is your husband. The Lord of hosts is his name, and the Holy One of Israel is your Redeemer." And that's just a wonderful truth for us to absorb, that God, our Maker, is our husband for those of us who believe in him, the one who would protect us, care for us, keep us safe, but actually buy us back, redeem us for himself. And so we're going to sing our first hymn together, a hymn that celebrates that truth and asks that question, and can it be that I, me, with all my failings, all the things that I've done wrong before God, that I should gain an interest in the Saviour's love? And let's celebrate and sing that together. It's praise number 776 if you're using the book, but the words will now be on your screens.
Thank you.
Well, let's now continue our worship after singing. Let's come before God together in prayer. Let's pray together. And so, our Father, we want to begin by just giving thanks to you for the sheer joy of knowing the forgiveness of all of our sins. Lord, of knowing that because of Jesus Christ and what he's done for us, that record of what's been done wrong in the past can be just wiped clean, paid for in full by Christ. How blessed and happy that makes us to be those who are redeemed by Christ's blood, those who were bought back, purchased by his own blood, and made fit for a relationship with you, so that we can think of ourselves as being at peace with you, friends with God, that you are our husband. Lord, we thank you for the blessing of being assured of this, because it's been done for us by Jesus Christ, never to be undone, never to be questioned, but that our standing before you is sealed in the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, as we give thanks to you for that, we would just pray for any who may be with us this evening, joining, who, as we give thanks for these things, they're just not quite there with it yet. And Lord, we thank you that they're there, listening and watching, and Lord, we pray that you would speak to them. Lord, that you may even open their eyes to have their sins forgiven. And Lord, that they may share in this joy of being right with God the Father through the Lord Jesus Christ. So Lord, please hear us and bless this time of worship together. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So we worship a God who seeks after the weak, the lame, and the blind, to bring them back to him. That's what our next hymn talks about. It says, "My God, full of mercy, heard our weeping, came to bring us home again." Let's sing our praise to our God, the God who seeks and saves the lost. My God, full of mercy.
Thank you.
I've got a few items of news to bring to you as a fellowship, just to bear in mind, but also as we pray in a moment, we'll bring some of them before the Lord in prayer. And the first is just to announce our welcome to Andy Lloyd Williams, who's going to be preaching for us this evening. Andy's known to us, he's the pastor at Brixworth Community Church, and so he's very kindly going to be preaching for us later on this evening. So our thanks to you, Andy, for doing that. And so it's great news that we've been hearing from the government that the lockdown restrictions are easing. And so there's this whole conversation going on about how do we get back to church at the moment. And it's been said that if going into lockdown was complicated, then coming out is several times more complicated. And the reason I say that is just to commend to you for your prayers, a group of people who are looking at how do we start up church again, still following the government's guidelines on social distancing, but allowing a small number of people to meet. So that's going to take some thinking through, it's going to take some wisdom, and it's going to take patience. We can't just run straight back to the way things were. We need to tread cautiously and seek the Lord's leading over how to do that sensibly. But we are encouraged that after not being able to do church properly for so long, there is that opportunity of actually meeting properly together in a albeit a limited way. So do be praying for that group of people as they consider those things. And just to mention in connection with that, I was talking to Andy Lloyd Williams the other night, and he said, well, it's actually even more complicated for us, because before lockdown they were meeting in a school. And that may not be immediately obvious to you why that's complicated, but if you think about some of the regulations we've got to consider, if you're meeting in a school, you've got even more considerations over the whole social distancing and lockdown, and how do you operate with a space that's being shared with other people, and how do you take responsibility for your part in it. So they've got a complex situation there at Brixworth that they've got to think through. So let's be in prayer for them as they consider what steps they may be able to make in the next few days in terms of their coming back together as a fellowship. This last night was a movie night, so that's an opportunity to discuss a movie. You watch the movie beforehand, but then our Pastor Paul leads a discussion around the themes of the movie, an opportunity to talk about how the gospel story just touches on so many other stories that are told. And so do look out for that if that's of interest to you. If you want to find out more about it, then Paul would be a good person to contact, or you just post a question on the Facebook page to find out about it. And then this Wednesday, instead of meeting in community groups, we're actually going to meet as a central Zoom prayer and praise meeting, an opportunity for us to get together, virtually, of course, but to pray as a whole church rather than in our separate smaller groups. So do come along to that if you can on Wednesday. If you're not sure how to join, then speak to me. I'll give you the sort of technical information on how to do it. But also bear in mind that if you don't have a computer, there is an option just to dial in by telephone, and you can join that way. We've tested it, we've proved it works, so just be aware that that's an option if that's what you need. So that's enough talking, let's come to God in prayer and let's bring some of these things to our Heavenly Father. And so, our Father in heaven, we would acknowledge now, as we have done before, that you are the God of all kindness and the God of all power and compassion. And Lord, Although it's hard for us to understand exactly how, we acknowledge that this pandemic is under your sovereign control. That, Lord, for reasons that are not fully understood to us, you have allowed it to happen. Lord, perhaps to lead us to repentance in ways we don't understand exactly the reasons, but Lord, we thank you for bringing us to a point where the situation has eased sufficiently that we're now being advised that meeting together in a limited way is a possibility. And so, Lord, we give you thanks for that, and Lord, pray for wisdom as we seek to understand how far to go with things at the moment. Lord, we pray that we wouldn't be inclined to rush ahead with things in an impatient way or even a slightly presumptuous way, but Lord, that we would follow in your lead. So we pray particularly for Peter Sker as he's looking at that, and Lord, some of our deacons and other church members who are investing in just considering this question, and the technical team also looking at how that's going to work. Lord, quite a number of people involved in asking difficult questions, but Lord, we just thank you that there's this possibility on the horizon. Lord, we pray we would use it well, that we'd use it safely, that we'd use it in a way that encourages and helps your people. Lord, particularly those for whom the lockdown and social distancing has been particularly difficult. Lord, we pray that this opportunity on the horizon may be a message of hope to them, may be of great help. And so, Lord, we ask that as we come together, we may be able to worship you in a fuller, richer way, to delight in our God together. Lord, we pray for our friends at Brixworth. Lord, we thank you that we're here, that similar to us, you've given to them people who are technically able, who've managed to move them onto the online platforms and meant that they could meet remotely as we do at the moment. But Lord, we pray for them as they consider this question, is meeting in a school going to work at all for us at the moment? Is that, and if so, how? Lord, we pray for Andy Lloyd Williams and his other church leaders as they ponder that one, as they pray over it. Lord, we pray that we may find, as churches, as we come together, we may find that you've been preparing soil. We may find that you've been at work in ways that we were scarcely aware of. And that, Lord, the work of sowing the gospel that has carried on during lockdown, we pray that we may find that actually it has borne fruit. Lord, that people have heard the message of Jesus Christ and that you've been at work in their lives. So Lord, we do pray for the strengthening and continuing of your church. Lord, we do pray for Andy as he comes to bring our message. Lord, we ask for ourselves as we hear what you're saying to us through Psalm 23 and through Andy. Lord, we pray that your spirit would be at work in our hearts to change us, to make us responsive to that message. And Lord, if we're challenged, if there are things that we hear that where we need to change, Lord, we pray that you would work in us so that we hear those things. And Lord, that change really does happen in us. Lord, we pray that we would be strengthened and equipped to live lives of righteousness, carried along by you, in your strength. Lord, for the glory of your great name, we pray. Amen. And so we're going to sing again before we hear from Andy. Whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. I wonder if that's something that resonates with you, that whatever happens, we can rest secure in belonging to the Lord Jesus Christ, that he will carry us on, will carry us through. And so we're going to sing a hymn that sort of teases that out and celebrates it. When Peace Like a River. And that's praise number 804, if you want to use your praise hymn books, or the words will be on your screen now.
Thank you.
reading this evening is from the book of Psalms, chapter 23, Psalm 23. Let's hear from God's word together. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Well, thanks very much for having me, Reynard Way. I do want to begin by asking you a question. Listen to these two names of two men, and I want you to ask yourself, who do you respect the most? Who has the most credible reputation? Lance Armstrong, Neil Armstrong. Now, apologies, it's a bit of a no-brainer, isn't it? Someone who has proven to be a cheat and a bully, whose reputation actually is pretty much in the gutter, or the first man on the moon. But names are important, aren't they? They are a key part of our identity. They can stir up emotions in us, whether it be good or bad, when we hear them. Even if we don't know the person themselves, but we actually know their reputation. And it's the same with God and why his name is important to him. In light of the reality of the fact that he decides to make himself known through his people. Because if we get on the right path and stay on the right path with him, following his son Jesus Christ, then we will reflect the very character of God and uphold his name and reputation. And of course, this will be hugely fulfilling for us, and we will do what we've been created to do, which is to glorify God and point people to Jesus Christ. But if we stay on the wrong path, that's go down a path without God, then ultimately the opposite will be true. We will end up being extremely unfulfilled. We won't do what we have been created to do. But ultimately, we will drag God's name through the gutter. And God won't have that. And Matthew chapter 7 makes it very clear that's a road that's going to end up in destruction. So today, this evening for you, is a time really where we can just be encouraged to get on the right path and stay on that path with God as we home in on a specific verse in Psalm 23, which we'll do that very shortly. But let's read Psalm 23 together. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for your rod are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And so, yes, the verse that we're looking at is verse 3. He guides me along right paths for his name's sake. Maybe your translation says he guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. But firstly, it's an encouragement. It's a very personal encouragement to just get on and stay on the right path with God. And I say it's a very personal encouragement because Psalm 23 is a very personal psalm. There is no we or they or us, but it's me, I, and you. And so our verse that we're looking at, it says, he guides me, which as it happens is right in between still waters and the valley of the shadow of death. And life can be very much like that, can't it? Is that one minute it can feel like that we're beside still waters and everything is great. But very suddenly, the next minute, it can feel like sometimes that we are going through the valley of shadow of death and it's an absolute nightmare. And as the COVID-19 experience will always remind us, life can change like that. But our Lord wants to be our personal guide through it all. And many of you watching and listening this will be able to testify to how our Lord does guide us very personally and uniquely, does he not? I mean, our Lord, he guides us through school and university or not, and in employment or not, or unemployment. He guides us through good health and bad health and house buying or not, and moving and travelling and parenting and grandparenting, and all the time he is providing for us. I mean, no one really can say that the Lord has left them short. Well, David couldn't. He said in verse 1, doesn't he? He says that the Lord is my shepherd. I want for nothing. And so I know that many people watching this and listening to this will be able to say those first three words in verse 3. Yes, he guides me. He guides me very personally. But let's just change the emphasis of those three words. Certainly changing the emphasis of the words he and me, because he guides me. Now, the Christian can be guided in life by many different things as we sort of travel down that road, if you like, that life. And I remember particularly a particular time, that was before a Christian actually, that I was guided, and I know that God spoke to me through a film. I think it was Gladiator, actually, near the end of the film. But I know God used that film as part of his plan on bringing me back onto the right path. And God speaks to us and guides us through many different things, whether it be films or art and music or creation. Yeah, and it says in the Psalms, the skies proclaim the work of his hands. Every day they pour forth speech. The sunset in these light evenings, do they not speak to us? And of course, God speaks and guides through our experiences, our life's coincidences, which actually aren't really coincidences at all, really. They're, to use the sort of Bible jargon, they're God's providences, that time where perhaps we're seeking God's guidance and something very uncanny happens and we say, yeah, that must have been God. All these can be clear signs in the way the Lord guides alongside his word. But the psalmist says, he guides me, and the he in the beginning of verse 3 is the Lord in verse 1, isn't it? The Lord my shepherd in verse 1. And the Lord my shepherd in verse 1, he came in human form 1,000 years after David wrote this psalm, and he came as Jesus, as the good shepherd. And the good shepherd says, my sheep listen to my voice, I know them, and they follow me. Now, last summer, myself and the family, we had a few days on a farm with a friend who is a farmer. And he was very graciously allowed us one by one to have a go on his quad bike. And of course, that was great fun. And he was saying to me that he farms with this quad bike as he sort of pushes the sheep on from kind of one field to the next, using this quad bike from behind the sheep and two dogs either side. But in David's day, a shepherd would kind of lead a flock. He wouldn't kind of stand behind them, but lead from the front by his words and his voice, not a quad bike. And the sheep would know the voice of the shepherd and they would follow. And so the point I'm saying to us all really this evening is this, is that yes, God speaks in many different ways and he leads, yes, by uncanny circumstances. But when we just begin to ignore God's word to us, then things can start to go a little bit awry in seeking God's direction. And And then when we ignore God's word altogether, well, that is when we can end up going in completely opposite direction to where the Lord wants us to go. Think of the prophet Jonah. So God says to Jonah to go off to Nineveh. Jonah's not so keen on that, but nonetheless, he goes off into a direction and he ends up in a port in Joppa. And it just so happens, quite uncannily, in fact, that there's a ship there and a captain, and he's willing to sort of accept and he's got the exact fare, and there's a captain willing to accept that exact fare for Jonah. You know, what could be clearer guidance than that? How uncanny would that be? It's amazing circumstances. Surely that it would be the Lord's will that Jonah would go off on that ship. But of course, no, it isn't. Because God has spoken to Jonah and said, go off to Nineveh, which was completely the opposite direction. Now, I guess the point that we're coming to here is, do not rely on uncanny circumstances alone, but seek God's word and seek his direction. As David's wise son Solomon once said in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Acknowledge him in all your ways and he will make your paths straight. Yes, he guides me. I guess that's the right path. But what about the dangers of going down the wrong path? David writes, he guides me along the right path. And it's just that word along which conveys that it really is step by step. And so sometimes the Lord has us on a path that really we wouldn't choose. I mean, God's character, his name, his reputation is probably most greatly upheld when we have to go through a difficult time or a difficult path, and yet we hold on to him. What a witness it is to see perhaps a Christian that you know and maybe love, and yet they're going through a difficult time, perhaps a long difficult time, maybe ill health. And that they're going through it, and yet they maintain a real closeness with God. And that's because the Lord wants to use our difficulties to bring us closer to him in a deeper way. What a privilege it is to see that in people. And so we need to be very wary of kind of seeking comfort, and very wary of seeking compromise with God's word, because it's not the goal just at the very end of it that matters. It's also the route we take along the way. And I think of the three pictures that we get in God's word in 2 Timothy chapter 2 that Paul writes to Timothy. He gives him in three pictures about the Christian life. And he talks about a soldier, an athlete, and a farmer. And all these three pictures, they convey kind of time and length and difficulty. The soldier spent long stints away from home. The athlete would spend many hours training. And the farmer would spent many hours out in the field. He was a hard-working farmer. And it was the Apostle Paul writing to his young protege Timothy and saying, Timothy, that actually, you know what, the Christian life can be hard. And it can be sometimes long as well. That path that the Lord has, it cannot be sometimes over quite quickly. And so avoid shortcuts. Avoid seeking to come off the path too quickly, or perhaps jumping on another path too soon. And so how do we apply that? Well, we can say, well, be careful that you don't rush into the wrong relationship too quickly, or perhaps don't get divorced too hastily. Or sometimes we can push for the kind of wrong job, but it's got more money, and all these things can lead us down the wrong path. I mean, let's think about David. Yeah, King David, after all, he wrote this psalm. I mean, David was never the finished article. In fact, there was a time in David's life where he went down a major wrong path. I mean, there is the beautiful Bathsheba, and she is bathing on her rooftop, and David sees her from his palace and he wants her, and he gets her. Actually, he goes to bed with her, and if that wasn't bad enough, that he conspires, bearing in mind this is the married Bathsheba, and if that wasn't bad enough, he conspires to have Bathsheba's husband kind of sent to the front line of battle to his certain death. And actually, when you read the verses that describe what happened in this season in David's life, you realise that he's just moved away from closeness with God. And of course, It's a challenge, really, and a warning to just stay close to in your relationship with God, because it's a sober reminder to us all that no one can be so high. No one can be in a, say, even a position of leadership, that they cannot fall morally and go down the wrong path. But the devil prowls around like a roaring lion looking for people to devour. And he tempts us with some obvious sins, the sins that David had to kind of face and sort of deal with. But he also tempts us with subtle sins and subtle things too. So if the devil can just get us, just get us off that path, not in a kind of major way, but just in a real subtle way, then that becomes a place of danger for us. So, you know, when we just perhaps, as an example, just stop reading our Bibles on a daily basis. Or maybe I could say to you, have you stopped just looking at these services really as regularly as that perhaps you should? Has it become, on a Sunday morning, the golf course instead? Well, in these ways, the devil can strike. In my more shameful moments growing up, my father would often say to me, and he was right to say this, he did it in a loving, correcting way, but I remember him saying to me, he said, "Son, you're going down the wrong path." Is our Father in heaven saying that to you? Well, back to David, and after the ministry, particularly this Bathsheba moment, after the ministry of the prophet Nathan, David is convicted by his sin, and he repents, and he is restored, and he comes back to closeness with God. You can see that by reading Psalm 51. But it says to us that if he can come back to closeness with God and be forgiven after adultery and then murder, then it reassures any of us that has just strayed onto the wrong path that there's always a way back for us too. And for us in New Testament times, I mean, that is through Jesus Christ. He says, "I am the way, the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." So Jesus is the only way to the Father, but also Jesus is the only way to forgiveness, no matter our sins, whether it be subtle or how dreadful. So we've had, I guess, the right path, the wrong path, but let's close by following the right person, Jesus Christ, and come back to him. Because if we acknowledge our sin and yet we turn to him and place our trust in him, that turn, if you like, is called repentance. The Bible calls that repentance. But we place our trust in him, whether it be for the first time or once again, or we make that a prayer or a pattern of prayer on a daily basis after the daily wrongs that we would do. But if we do that, the Bible is clear. 1 John 1:9 says that we are cleansed from all unrighteousness. Because Jesus was prepared to walk the longest, hardest path of all, culminating in his death on the cross, paying the price for every sin that we've ever done, becoming separated from God so that we don't have to be, so that we could come close to God again, and following his son, the good shepherd, again, and on the right path again, and then listening to his voice and being guided by his word again, he will guide us ultimately all the way home, which is heaven. Yes, we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever after we die. But as we live, yes, Reynard Way, may we live and uphold his name and reputation. Thanks very much for listening. It's a great privilege to be with you and share God's word with you. Take care. Hope to see you soon.
Well, thanks, Andy, for helpfully coming to share with us and leaving us with something of a challenge to think about and to pray over. We're grateful to you for that. Let's close our service by singing the psalm that Andy was speaking on. We're going to sing praise number 23C, the C version of the psalm, "The King of Love, My Shepherd Is." Let's sing that together. close with a final prayer. Let's pray together. And now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory for ever and ever. Amen.